well, thanks everyone for coming. It's nice to see so many people here. And I'm Brian Oster. If you don't know me, I'm one of the owners of Catland Books. And it was only a few months ago, I think, that we had a talk here by a mutual friend named Enrique Enriquez. You've encountered his work before. And he was kind enough to put me in contact with Dr. Yoav Ben-Dov, who is a former physics professor at the University of Tel Aviv, the author of the first Hebrew book on tarot, as well as the author of The Open Reading, which is a book on the Marseille tarot deck, which we have available here tonight in the back. So he's come a very long way. We're very excited to have him. He's going to be teaching us about quantum, as you probably know from the events page and everything else. Quantum physics, psychomagic, creating your own reality, and what that has to do with this very old and very mysterious, wonderful tarot deck, the Tarot de Marseille. He's also done some work with Alejandro Jodorowsky?
Jodorowsky.
So that's also a sort of interesting, exciting connection there. Well, anyways, without further ado, please help me in welcoming Dr. Yoav Ben-Dov.
Okay, and I'm completely clueless with Mac computer, so if I run into trouble, Brian is here to save the day. Okay, good evening, everybody. What we are going to speak about today is starting with science, quantum physics, already. Quantum physics, which is science physics, and we go all the way to magic and tarot, and we try to get there in one piece or whatever. So it's going to be a little charge, but let's go on. I assume that many of you have already heard about quantum physics and read something about it. There are many books about quantum physics and mysticism, Eastern mysticism. There were several films, What the Bleep Do We Know, The Secret. Everybody have heard about it? Because I don't want to repeat things that you have read there. So we shall try to advance to other ground. And also, with the tower, yes, I have my book here, I wrote enough there. I'm not going to repeat things that I did in the book. So we shall try to explore some new ideas, some new directions, and bring everything together, because in a way, this is something that shifts your whole view of reality and what you can do and what you cannot do, and what we shall see it in the second part, that it puts old traditions of magic and mysticism in a new context, that you can connect the things, but with a new awareness of today. So, first of all, what about quantum physics? Now, in most of the books that I read about it, they say, okay, once we were in Newtonian worldview, and suddenly it collapsed, and now we are quantum. One small thing about it, Newton himself was a mystic, was an alchemist, astrologer. He dealt a lot with prophecies of the Bible. So yeah, that's not the rational scientist that you know or that you read about in the books. There are many stories about it and why it was buried for many years, and somehow his writings got in a very obscure way to Jerusalem, and we are planning next year maybe a conference about the real Newton. But that's aside, that's not our main concern here. What is important is that, yes, there was a worldview. It wasn't Newton. Newton just provided the equations. His world vision was completely different, much closer to what is here in the store. But still, about 100 years after Newton, there emerges some kind of a worldview, which is physics, philosophy, and a way to approach the world, and a way to understand the place of human being and consciousness in the world. And this is called mechanism. It comes from philosophy, from Descartes, the French philosopher, who introduces the idea that for us, for modern people, is self-evident, but it's not. Yeah? That the whole universe is like a clock, like a material machine, the separate parts of matter, which are moving according to mathematical laws. Incidentally, it's laws of Newton, but that's not the main point. And that everything there is preconditioned by the laws. So everything is fixed in advance. Everything is rational, mathematic, no meaning, no purpose, no good and bad, because it's just particles of matter moving according to fixed laws. And even my sensation, my idea that I have free will and I have meaning and I have all this internal world, this is an illusion, because something already in my brain, the motions already determine that at a certain moment my lips will move in a certain way and my lungs will move in a certain way. I say, I have free will, but I'm a robot, an automaton, who just makes this sound. It has no meaning. So as far as spirituality, mysticism, magic was concerned, meaning, purpose, finality, or soul, good and bad, yeah, morality, all this became an illusion, something that we imagine in our head, but it's not objective fact. Objective fact is that these particles of motion. And this idea that the world should be conceived like this had a lot of implication. It created the whole world, because as you create the solar system, you also create the human body. So what is a man, what is human, it is a machine. So we treat it in medicine, we separate mind and body. Mind, okay, leave it outside, it's for the psychologist. Maybe scientists, maybe not, okay. And we take apart the systems of the body, like you take apart a car at the garage, yeah? Because there are different systems and one does not affect another, and you find the part which went wrong and you replace it, and that's it, and the machine is okay. Or the idea of society as a machine, a rational machine, which should function smoothly, so you can take a screw from one part and put it another, it's the same, it will work. Things don't have their heritage, their growth. Yeah? You cannot imagine that you take a toe and replace it with the ear, yeah? For the idea of equality, yes, because the ear is going to concert and hearing nice things, and the toe is like this, and, tucked like this in the shoe. Yeah? That's unjust, so why not replace from time to time? No. The idea is inconceivable in an organic worldview. But in a mechanistic worldview, so you have these many things that we want. We want equality of opportunities. We want to be able to move ourselves socially. But also, we feel like parts of a machine. So we work in these boxes, in our big houses, which are housing machines, and we work in this cubicles of offices, at the factory. So we become material machines, and our existence is defined only through the material. So you can imagine your religion, your spirituality, that's your private thing. Okay, nobody really cares about it as long as it does not mean something material, it is meaningless. But the rules of society, the rules to be organized our world, are material and individualistic. So because we are like the parts of the machine, separate from the rest of the universe. And this is something that for modern people sounds evident. Of course it's like this, but it's not. Most people in most historical periods thought otherwise, thought of the world as an organism, not as a machine. So just a little thing about how it looks. I have something very nice.
Until quite recently, we explained that...
No. I'll do it here.
The Greeks. We lived, it seemed, in a clockwork universe.
This is...
...done by immutable laws.
Old-fashioned science. And everything is like this. This is a machine.
...identified by Sir Isaac Newton in the 17th century. Initially, he described how gravity rules the motion of the planets.
But this is the world. This is a machine. The clock.
Physical systems obeyed these laws. And that the key to accurate prediction was simply accurate measurement. In fact, this new natural philosophy seemed to lead inevitably to a conclusion, first proposed by French mathematician Pierre-Simon Laplace, that if you could exactly measure the position and motion of every point in the universe, predicting the rest of eternity would be simply a matter of doing the sums.
Okay. So... this is a crash course in mechanistic philosophy or physics. And if you studied physics in high school or you remember the books there, this is how they look. Okay? Maybe you didn't because it looked like this. What is missing? Yes, what is missing? It's missing the human. Yeah? And the whole romantic movement in the 19th century, which was against these ideas, tried to say, no, there's human, there's meaning, there's emotion, there's a feeling, yeah? There's morality in the world. But they lost because you can sing about how beautiful is this valley and the trees, but once the factory comes and the train comes, you cannot stand against it. It's too powerful, it's too brutal. So it erases everything. And what happened, and this is something which was the biggest shock for the physicists of the beginning of the 20th century, that when you go into the atoms, which were first considered as the great victory of mechanism, because here we found the basic building blocks. Okay? So here, this is what the machine is made of. But then, suddenly, the same physics which led us there became crazy. So just a little thing about... this, how do we consider this transition? So I took a very, very short a piece that I edited from What the Bleed Do We Know, because what happened is that in quantum mechanics, the new theory which emerged, there were two things. First, the basic ideas that were before in mechanism, which were particle and wave, and we shall go deeper into this, yeah? What is particle? What is a wave? What is the meaning of this concept? They started to interfere with each other. An electron, we know a lot about electrons, yes, we have a lot of technology about electrons, but when we try to define, is it a wave, is it a particle, we don't know, but something is very confusing, and we shall just touch a little about it. But something worse is happening. When we ask, when is the electron a particle and when is it a wave? It depends on our observation, on the experiment that we do. And we can decide whether it will manifest itself as a particle or as a wave. Why is this so important? This is important because it brings consciousness back into the game. So let us try to understand what's going on here. We have, first of all, you have this classical mechanics.
Not long ago, we thought we had it pretty much figured out. The rules that govern how planets orbit the sun.
These are particles, okay?
How a ball.
Small pieces of matter.
Arcs
again,
the sky.
Particles, small piece of matter. But there's also another thing, a wave.
Move across the surface of a pond. These laws were all spelled out in a series
of. Okay, and this is the whole world.
Classical mechanics.
And the separation is very clear.
To predict the behavior of things with certainty.
Okay.
It all seemed to be making perfect sense.
Okay, so first of all, we have certainty, we have sense, where everything is makes sense, and we have this particle and wave. So, okay, so what is this thing about particle and wave? First, let's start with particle because this is the basic idea. What is a particle? Of course, physicists would say, okay, this is a physical concept. But there is one thing which is very important to understand, and this is if you don't have a concept of something in your brain, you will never be able to see it, not in front of your eyes, and not in physics, and not anywhere. Which means there cannot be any physical concept which does not have some grounding in our inner world, because otherwise we would not project it on the equation. We would not be able to write it down, because we will not have this pattern, this structure in our brain. So every physical concept is not something objective which exists in nature. It is something that we can understand nature with it. Okay? So you cannot say anything which is not in language. Okay? You cannot see anything which your eyes cannot perceive. Okay? This is obvious, but we have to remember it because this world of the mechanistic world was considered to be as such objective without us looking at it. Okay? We never appeared, there are no life on Earth, okay? The planets and the atoms continue to spin according to the same laws. But, of course, we are here and we are describing all this. So when we speak about a particle, this is not a new physical concept. This is something which comes from ancient Greece. The atom. What is an atom? Is something which is individual. It is indivisible in Greece, and in Latin you say individual. So the atom is something like our own individuality, or if you want, our own ego. The fact that we can isolate ourselves from all the world. So how is a particle? Imagine I was studying physics, so we would do such a problem. A single particle alone in space, and it still exists, you can still define it. You have particles, atoms, and empty space around them. Can you see the image? Yes, okay, so from time to time, two atoms can interact, okay? They can exchange something, okay? So we can exchange money, goods, hugs, kisses, body liquids, yes, whatever, yeah? But basically you are alone. You encounter another person or another atom, you exchange something with him, and then you go away. Because your life is your own existence. Just from here and there you have interaction. So the whole society is around the individual, the existence of the individual, the rights of the individual, the pursuit of happiness of the individual. Yes, you know this from your constitution, I think, or something. Yeah? This is the ideal, because everything is individual and everything is defined individual, and you decide your life as an individual and you want to maximize your gains or something like this in this interaction. But basically, you are alone. And on one hand, this is what the basis of modern society. That you don't owe anything to anyone. You just have to pay your taxes or whatever, obey the laws, and you go on. And this is what society should give you, and this is how you should be educated. Okay? But when you envelop yourself in your own individuality, there is something about human nature that we all know. You start to lose the feeling of meaning to your life. and you feel that it's empty, because if it's only about you, then what for? Okay, if you die, you don't feel anything bad, so why bother? Okay, what is the meaning? And the feeling of meaning cannot be from this idea of individuality. So all the time there was this resistance to the idea of the individual, the solitary existence. So we all the time we need something to counter this particle. But yet, we have this feeling of individuality, which is very strong. If you know about Ayn Rand, yeah? She took this rationalist philosophy to the extreme, okay? There's no rationality in caring for others, just doing commerce. So if the deal is not good, whether it's your parents or your children or your life partners or whatever, yeah? Just get out of the deal, because no rationality can justify caring for others. So you become a particle, and to understand how it feels to be a particle, the best example that I found is a song by two, maybe you don't know them as physicists, but, and there is a way to make this work, yes? Yes. Listen to the words. No, but the words. Winter, cold.
In a deep and dark.
Dark. Alone.
To the streets below. On a freshly fallen silent shroud of snow. I am.
Death. Yeah? Snow, coldness. Hard. This is individual. Yeah? I'm alone.
I have my books.
I just cut to the end.
And my poetry to protect me.
Rationality you have, yes. Brain.
I am shielded in my heart.
Sealed. Again, isolated.
I touch no one and no one touches me.
I touch no one. No one
I am
me.
A rock. I am an island. And a rock feels no pain. And an island never cries.
Okay, the two last lines drive the nail into the heart, of course, but okay, let's go on. Because feeling, okay, we miss here the idea of emotion, love, okay? But this is the projection of the idea of particle, which comes from our feeling of individual, and then we imagine atoms and particles and material pieces of matter separate, and we go on from the Greeks with the idea of atoms, and finally we end up with the electron as a particle. But there is also a wave. A wave is something different. It's not alone. It's part of something. So all the time we have this other concept, which also starts with the Greek, because for the Stoics say that the whole world is like a movement of something that they call pneuma. Yes? It's like the spirit which is moving, and we are just a motion of this spirit, so we are not alone, we are part of. And in classical physics, matter was particles, light was waves, was this kind of movement of something, and at the beginning they called it ether, they thought it was some kind of matter, different kind of matter, and in the 20th century they called it field, but it's the same thing, okay, we don't know what it is, but something moves, something like this vibrates, and this vibration is us. Now, to understand what is a wave, first of all, a wave is not something which exists by itself. It is a motion of something. So let's look at a wave of something.
Is it
You see, something is moving. That's a wave. Something is moving, but nothing is moving. See? Here, like this, a wave. So it can propagate from one place to another. It can transfer energy, information. Okay. Okay. Okay, let's go on because it goes on and on like this, but you got the idea. This is in Thailand. This is crazy, but it's nice. But you understand what is a wave? It's not something something to go like this. It is a movement, but here you cannot isolate any single part of it, because every soldier is not a wave by itself. The wave is something which exists in the, we call it a medium in physics, okay? Something which moves, it's like water or like the electromagnetic field, or when it comes to the electron, there is some wave there, and we can see there's some wave motion because it can go from here and interact, like waves that are interacting from when they come from two different places. We don't know what the wave of what it is, but it is not important. The idea is that it is a wave, and we can see that it is not something that you can isolate. Okay, so what does it mean when we feel that we are a wave? We can also feel this, because it's also is grounded in our feeling. And what is the opposite pole to feeling that you are an individual isolated from the world? To feel that you lose your boundaries, that you become absorbed in something which is bigger than you. And this is what gives people the sense of meaning. This is a psychological fact, but it's also something very deep inside us. You get a feeling of meaning and purpose when you pay a price to acknowledge that you are part of something bigger than you. So it's always, meaning is always outside you. It is something that absorbs you. And when sometimes we can feel it, we lose our boundaries. Yes, it's an oceanic feeling. Maybe it's in nature. Maybe it's a religious ecstasy. Yes, that you lose your individuality. All the mystics always speak about it, about losing your sense of the ego, losing your subjective boundaries, and immersing yourself in something which is bigger, nirvana, Tao, whatever, yes? Or even the feeling of love or feeling of belonging, or even when you lose yourself, and people love this feeling, yeah? Losing yourself with 20,000 people all applauding something in sports, yeah? And suddenly it carries you away. Okay, and it's also frightening because it can think also of rallies in Nazi Germany, okay, because you can manipulate this feeling into something which is evil. But the important thing is that we need this. We need this feeling, and we can approach it, and we can touch it. And when we touch it, we feel something deep in us, which is much better than to be an individual. Yeah? That we work all day long, yes, to strengthen these limits of the individual, but our true happiness is those moments when we lose them. So how does it feel to be a wave, part of the wave? You are not a wave yourself, you are part of. Yeah? So again, the best explanation I found about the wave concept is from a strange film, which was called I Love Huckabees. The film is not so good, but this part is wonderful.
This is part of my investigation?
Yes. Say this blanket represents all the matter and energy in the universe, okay? You, me, everything. Nothing has been left out, all right? All the particles, everything.
What's outside this blanket?
More blankets, that's the point.
Blankets, everything.
Exactly. This is everything, okay? Let's just say that this is me, right? and I'm, what, 60-odd years old, and I'm wearing a gray suit, blah, 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 and let's say over here, this is you, and you're, I don't know, you're 21, you've got dark hair, etc., and over here, this is Vivian, my wife and colleague, and then over here, this is the Eiffel Tower, right? It's Paris, and this is a war, and this is a museum, and this is a disease, and this is an orgasm, and this is a hamburger.
Everything is the same, even if it's different.
Exactly. But our everyday mind forgets this. We think everything is separate, limited. I'm over here, you're over there, which is true, but it's not the whole truth, because we're all connected. Because we are connected.
Okay. So we have this other idea of something should be, should happen here. I don't know. Okay. We're back. So we have these two concepts, which are human concept and physical concept. And the thing is that in physics, until 100 years ago or more, a little more, we have these two concepts, which are given mathematical structures and are applied to objects in the world. So we have this light, which is always something not completely within science. Light is something which evokes spirituality, and electromagnetic fields is always has some flirting relationship with mysticism. You have, even today, you speak about magnetism, and you have this field of bioenergy. Okay, so it always, you have this idea that the field, the wave is not completely materialistic, it's something beyond matter. But in the physics, it was clearly delimited. We are matter, surrounded maybe by fields of light, of electromagnetic fields, and we are particles of matter, and everything is a particle. The important thing in quantum mechanics is not that it shifted from particle to wave. It's worse, because this was something that the physicists could swallow. Okay, it's a different equation, different concept, but still, it's clear. The important thing is, as I said before, but I'll resume it because with this we have to advance. You take an electron. You know a lot about electron. We can manipulate electrons in a wonderful way, unimaginable in previous generations. Okay, so we know exactly where it would land, and how to make it go exactly here. But when we ask what is an electron, is it a particle, which means this thing, small piece of matter which is separate from everything else, or is it a wave? Is it some kind of a movement that can go in experiments through both ways? We have the two slits experiment. Those of you who know it, fine. Those of you who don't know it and want to get more into it, you can find on YouTube. So go and see it. If you don't understand, go and see it, and you'll better not understand. Okay, you don't understand much better, and then you see it again, and then you will not understand more. Okay, and then you can study it for 30 years and not understand, because it's something that goes beyond our idea of rationality, that the particle, the electron, is sometimes a wave, sometimes a particle, and this is an experiment. Okay. So sometimes you have to use particles, sometimes you have to use wave. But as I said, the most baffling things is that it is your decision. So something about reality becomes not objective. It depends on your decision how to look at it. And of course, most physicists prefer to brush it aside because it's very embarrassing. Okay? It means that physics is not everything. It's a vision, a partial vision of reality. It's not the whole vision of reality. So I remember it, the same, it happened again and again in a course, courses that I took as a student, or in books that I wrote. Okay, electron, something there, wave particle, we don't understand. Something strange about the electrons. Okay, we don't understand. Let's finish this. Talking about this because we cannot advance it. Okay, let's move on to the equation. This we can solve. And we can solve them, and we solve them very good, very beautifully. Yeah? We can predict the results of experiment, we can have an amazing technology. Okay, but when you ask, what is it all about? You're stuck again in this question. So, some people have started to think, and this, again, you know, otherwise I suppose you wouldn't come to a lecture about quantum mechanics, that they started to think, okay, if consciousness, if the observer, the human observer is so important, maybe it is essential, it's not something which is external to the physical phenomena, but maybe we could turn everything around. Just a very short thing about this new vision. This is Amit Goswami.
That even the material world around,
it's from Blip.
The chairs, the tables, the rooms, the carpet, camera included, all of these are nothing but possible movements of consciousness. And I'm choosing moment to moment, moment out of those movements to bring my actual experience into manifestation. This is the only radical thinking that you need to do. But it is so radical, it's so difficult, because our tendency is that the world is already out there, independent of my experience. It is not. Quantum physics has been so clear about it. Heisenberg himself, co-discoverer of quantum physics, said atoms are not things. They are only tendencies. So, instead of thinking of things, you have to think of possibilities. They're all possibilities of consciousness.
Okay, so now you turn the world around and you say, okay, it's not matter which gives rise to consciousness in the brain, it's consciousness which is choosing from the possibilities of matter, because matter is like a wave, it exists in different possibilities, maybe, again, yeah, maybe I suppose you heard the Schrödinger cat, it's alive and dead, both, okay? So it's a wave of two possibilities, and they're both existing until you look at it. And when you look at it, it becomes like a particle, either here or there, either alive or dead. Okay, so what is your role here? Yeah? And what Goswami, Amit Goswami, this is a person that you saw, he's a physicist, he's not an Indian guru. Yeah? So he comes from physics and goes back into spirituality and say, okay, let's turn it around. Let's look at consciousness not as something which is strangely infiltrated physics. No, we should not take mechanism as self-evident. Let's swipe clean and start anew. And what is the basic thing here? The basic thing is the observer, the observation. And this is the moment where reality becomes manifest. And until this moment of observation, it is possibility, it is a wave of possibility. So you should put consciousness back into this. Ah, consciousness, okay, I have consciousness. You have consciousness, okay? Human consciousness. And if consciousness can affect reality even on the physical level, so maybe you can start to shape reality, okay? And what does it mean to shape reality? So it starts with things like what the bleep do we know, where there's this girl who has her life, everything goes wrong, and she's a victim, and everything happens to her, bad things happen to her, and she learned the lesson of quantum mechanics, that she can change. So let's just see the highlight from this film to understand what it's about.
Welcome to Duke Reginald's Court of Unending Possibilities.
In fact, the universe is mostly empty.
We like to think of space as empty and matter as solid. But in fact, there is essentially nothing to matter whatsoever. It's completely insubstantial. Take a look at an atom. We think of it as a kind of hard ball. Then we say, oh, well, no, not really. It's this little tiny point of really dense matter right at the center, surrounded by a kind of fluffy probability cloud of electrons popping in and out of existence. But then it turns out that that's not even right. Even the nucleus, which we think of as so dense, hops in and out of existence just as readily as the electrons do. The most solid thing you can say about all this insubstantial matter is that it's more like a thought. It's like a concentrated bit of information.
What makes up things are not more things, but what makes up things are ideas, concepts, information.
Modern materialism strips people of the need to feel responsible. And often enough, so does religion. But I think if you take quantum mechanics seriously enough, it puts the responsibility squarely in your lap, and it doesn't give answers that are clear-cut and comforting. It says, yes, the world is a very big place. It's very mysterious. Mechanism is not the answer, but I'm not going to tell you what the answer is.
When you ain't looking, it's like a wave. When you are looking, it's like a particle.
When you are not looking, there are waves of possibility. When you are looking, then there are particles of experience.
A particle, which we think of as a solid thing, really exists in a so-called superposition, a spread out wave of possible locations. And it's in all of those at once. The instant you check on it, it snaps into just one of those possible positions.
Quantum superposition implies that a particle can be in two places, two or more places or states simultaneously. And this is a very bizarre concept and one of the hallmarks of the quantum world.
Superheroes use superposition, with the world being potential strips of reality, until we choose. Heroes choose what they want, being in many places at once, experiencing many possibilities all at once, and then collapsing on the one. The question is, how far down the rabbit hole do you want to go?
Okay. So, okay, we understand that we can shape reality with our consciousness, and yet we know that it's not so simple, because at the beginning, I don't know, maybe you saw The Secret, okay? They said, okay, just ask, okay? Just you have to say you want, okay? And your consciousness can create it. And it is not working. And now you can ask, okay, why is it not working? And how can we make it work? And what can we learn from quantum mechanics about it? So, first of all, it's when you're thinking, I saw the Secret. Try to look at it attentively, and they mix mind and thought. Mind is not thought. And when you are just thinking, it's like positive thinking, it works for a moment, but then it looks, okay, this is very short, so where is it? Here. It is from a film, an old film by Ernst Lubitsch. They invented positive thinking already in the 30s, so...
I feel fine. It was a nice day yesterday. It'll be a nice day today. It'll be a nice day tomorrow. I feel fine. I feel fine. I feel very fine.
This many new age.
It was a nice day yesterday. It's a nice day today. It'll be a nice day.
Workshops tomorrow. Look
fine.
Like this.
I feel fine. I feel very fine.
How are you today, Mr. Brandon?
Not so good. I feel fine. I feel fine. I feel very fine. It was a nice day yesterday. It's a nice day today. It'll
be your luncheon, Mr. Brandon?
Mutton stew.
Now, Mr. Brandon.
I feel fine. I like mutton stew. I like mutton stew yesterday. I like mutton stew today. I like mutton stew tomorrow. Yeah. I feel fine. I feel fine. I feel very fine. I feel...
Yes. I saw many experiences like this. But okay, what's the problem here? First of all, we are not speaking about thought. When we speak about consciousness, we are thinking about something deeper. Okay, so consciousness, what is consciousness? This Amit Goswami that you saw here, he has a whole film which is called The Quantum Activist, and it's quite sharp on this point. So I'll just summarize what he says because we want to move forward with it. He said, okay, what were you using this shaping of reality for? Okay, for a better car, to manifest a better car, or they show the pearl necklace that you see in the shop, or even better relationships, because this is also considered something of achievement, okay? So a better partner, a good-looking partner, I don't know, hot sex, I don't know, whatever. So all this you put forward, the idea of your individual needs, which means that you take quantum mechanics and you are trying to use the ideas of quantum mechanics, but the goals are the goals of the individual, which means that the goals, you still are at the level of the goals of the particles. So you opened from particle to particle wave consciousness, which plays between them, but eventually you want to go back to the particle in your goals. So something is wrong about it. And what Goswami says, yes, there's a catch here. You can shape reality, consciousness can shape reality, but it's not individual consciousness. And he calls it, quantum consciousness. He speaks about God. I think he brings it from India, if you know about Atman, which is individual consciousness, which is identical with Brahman, the cosmic consciousness. Okay, so I think that's what he thinks about, just doesn't say it because he speaks to a Western audience. But we have to reconsider this thing of particle and wave. And when I started with this, I did my doctorate on quantum philosophy of quantum mechanics, and I was believing in Niels Bohr, who said there is complementarity between particle and wave. And until now, I presented them as two things, two concepts which are equivalent, okay? So it's particle and wave, and it's either or, and you have to choose if you see particle or you see a wave. But quantum mechanics goes beyond this. And this is something that happened in the last 40 years, that attention became, physicists turned their attention to the idea, because they discovered, at the beginning nobody believed that it would work. It was a physicist named John Bell who did some calculation in 1964, and he found something amazing, and he was sure that it will not work once it gets to the experiment. And it took about 10 years until they started to make experiments because the technology was not so good. And it took 20 years, only in the beginning of the 80s, that the experiments became conclusive. What John Bell discovered, that quantum mechanics, if it is right, if the experiments won't break it in this instance, and this, everybody hoped that, okay, here quantum mechanics will fail. And even John Bell, I spoke with him, he died in 89, but I had some conversation with him, and I said, look, I read your article, okay? You are known as a person who discovered that particles affect each other, that there's some information which passes between this electron here and this electron there. And the experiment has confirmed that this is happening. The information passes from one side to another. And at that time, it was in the 80s, they managed to do it 17 meters, which is a lot for electrons. Today, they have, in the Canary Islands, they have an experiment, they got to 100 miles, okay, from one side to another, okay, from one particle to another. And there's some information which passes. You make a measurement here, and the result of the measurement here change as a result, a correlation. And you find the correlation when you bring them together, the two results. And you see that the result you got here and the result you got here are correlated in a way that cannot be explained by something which passes. And it happens quicker than light, because you can do today experiments which are so quick that you change something here before light has a time to get to the other side. You measure something there and you find the correlation. It's like you have two thieves which have an alibi and you interrogate them separately, okay? And they answer the same question to everything that you ask. So you said that this cannot be, okay? Because they could not prepare all these answers beforehand. So they must have some kind of transmission between them, okay? To make the everything that I ask here, I get the same answer there, okay? So, and I ask things that you could not imagine all those details, and still it corresponds. So some information passes, they have some radio transmitter between them, transition or some telepathy, okay, to pass. Am I clear, by the way? Yeah, my English and, okay. Yeah? And so, because it's not clear, okay? Nobody understands what goes on there. But somehow, you take these pieces, separate them, and they are still connected. They need to have a common past, but all the particles in the universe have a common past because they all started with the Big Bang. So everything is connected. Do you remember this blanket? Underneath the appearance of particles, everything is connected. So the wave is something deeper than the particle. Because on the surface, it's particles here and there. Here's the Eiffel Tower, here's a hamburger in McDonald's America, okay? And they are separate, okay? No, in a deeper level, they are connected. So in the deeper level, it's a wave. And I asked Don Well because I said, I read your article and from the words, you can't see it in the question, but I'm something that physicists don't do. They read the words between the equations. And I have this feeling that you hoped that quantum mechanics will break down, that still locality will be preserved, that everything will remain only in its own place. And he said something, yes, if it would be so, then my career would be much better or something like that. But I had this feeling that he is really a little sorry that it got this way, because he wanted, John Bell believed in realism, believed in mechanism in a way. Yeah? He wanted things to remain in their place. But it's clear, it's evident, many experiments have shown this, you cannot keep it. There is some connection, underlying connection, which means the wave is there, more basic than the particles. And there's another thing, which is very, very obscure. So obscure, it touches some deep points, philosophical points, so that almost nobody is writing about it. I wrote about it in a book about quantum mechanics, but it's only in Hebrew. So I'm planning something in new, so I will put it there also. But there's something very strange, very strange. If you take two identical particles, okay, and you bang them one on the other, okay? You hit one particle with another, like in collision experiments, okay? And they go both ways, and they're both electrons, so they're identical. You cannot distinguish. So there are two stories that you can tell. One is, I just painted them to keep track of the identities, okay? One is that the blue, they're the same, okay? You cannot distinguish, but let's call one blue and one red, okay? Blue comes, hits red, and then either blue goes up and red goes down, or red goes up and blue goes down. These are two different stories, yes? God, he knows every particle. So he looks, he knows whether it's first story or second story. But it turns out that in the experiment, not only that you cannot distinguish, that's something technical, okay? But you have to take the calculation as if both stories are happening. And you have a superposition. It's like the cat alive and dead. In identical particles, you have superposition of exchanging of all the particle identities between them. Which means that if, this is very unclear, okay? Very unclear, because I touch here something, the self-identity is some concept that is evident, I am me, I am I, okay, and you are you, and we don't exchange our identity, so I have these two balls, one came from here, one came from there, okay? I cannot distinguish between them, and that this is the ball that came from here, this is the ball that came from there, okay? Even though I cannot distinguish technically between them. But there is a distinction, there is this self-identity, it's something very basic, it's not mechanism. It goes back to Aristotelian physics, it goes back to when you were babies and they hide an object and then they put it back and you know, you recognize it, it's the same object, there is a continuity of identity. And in quantum mechanics, this continuity is lost. Those of you who know something about Buddhist philosophy know that this is something which resonates exactly with the idea of Buddhist philosophy. The only phenomena, there is no self-identity. Self-identity is an illusion. Okay? There's only an electronic happening here, an electron happening here, and an electron happening there. But the next time, there's another happening here with the electron, but it's not an object. There's no self-identity which passes from one moment to another. Are people here know about Buddhist philosophy? Yeah. This is exactly the idea that I exist moment to moment. There is some causality between moment to moment. There is no essential identity which passes from one to another. And what we discovered in quantum mechanics that it's the same about particles. There is no self-identity. So particles have self-identity because a particle exists by itself. It does not depend on other things. A wave does not have. You cannot say, okay, this is one wave, this is another wave. When they merge, they separate. Is it the same wave that came from here or that came from here? You don't ask this question. They imagine these soldiers, okay? Now, when you go down like this, is it because of the movement from here, which was originally here, or is it because of a movement from there? No, both, okay? You cannot distinguish between these parts of the movement, okay? So, what I'm trying to get out of it is that quantum mechanics says, and this is, again, you have to look in the details, okay? There's something that I understood only in recent years, but okay, this is what it means, that the wave is more basic than the particle. It looks like a wave to your vision when you look at it, okay? It appears like a particle, it appears that the world is separate, but underneath it is common. It is something which exists all over at once. Okay, so now when we speak about shaping reality, we understand that we have to think beyond the individual. We have to think about something which connects us. So how do you go beyond the limits of the individual and connect into consciousness to shape reality? And when I ask this kind of thing, you want to shape reality with consciousness when you go beyond the individual. We know such things. Thousands of years we know such things. This is called magic. And humanity has developed techniques to do it. So you just have to ask, what are the techniques that were developed? What are the structures that people discovered? How do they apply it beyond the special features of this or that tradition? Okay? How do people do it? And how do they represent it in their symbols? Because magic, to touch this reality which exists beyond the individual, and which exists in you, okay, you can, of course, you do meditation, okay, you go beyond yourself, you do mystical experience, you go beyond yourself, but if you are interested in shaping reality, you have to correspond to something which is more specific, okay? You have to connect with something which is more specific. How to shape your reality when you have, as Aleister Crowley, who knew something, knew a lot about magic, he said, okay, when you do magic, yeah, when you, this is your true will, what is true will? It's true will, which is not something individual, which is the whole universe is manifest to you. Okay, so he says every man and every woman is a star, okay, so it's a part of the system, it's not alone, okay? And it's part of the system. And when you connect to this, you can do anything because the whole universe resonates with you. Okay, so I will explore this thing with Jodorowsky's ideas in second part, but just to finish it, okay, this idea, thing about particle and wave is something very basic. So if it is something that we can explore, if it is something that we can explore, let's see if it works, magic. Then we can ask, okay, how do the symbols of the Tao, which will be our main tool, how are the symbols reflecting this idea of individuality and particle and wave? And I will just briefly touch it. I don't really go into it explicitly in my book about the Tao, but I touch it, yes, because I explain, when I explain each card separately, and this is the Tao de Marseille. This is my restoration of the classical version, which again I did because I thought, okay, it's not this or that school. It is something which a collective of humanity develops for hundreds of years. So it is a shaping through the consciousness, the common consciousness of many generations and many people, and it goes undergoes evolution until it reaches its summit, which is 18th century, the specific version by Nicolas Convert, the most powerful and influential historical Tao ever made. And so this has power. Okay, so I'm trying to look at the power. And this is the individual. I don't know, people still read Castaneda? Yeah. Okay, so maybe you remember in the journey to Ixtlán, he takes, Don Juan takes Carlos to the desert and shows him a table and the object on the table, and this is the tonal, this is your consciousness creating this object, but it's not reality. It's just perceived reality. There is the desert, infinite. Okay, this is true reality, the Nahual. Yeah? Nahual. I don't know how to pronounce it. Okay. Okay. So this is number one. Man, what is number one? Individual, the magician who creates reality. So it's like reality. Yeah? And of course it's an illusion. Because if you look closely on the details, you see that on the side here, you see? You don't, and it's clear here, but it's not so clear on the sides. Okay? Or the earth is solid, but it's not solid. You see? It doesn't exist. It's an illusion also. So the magician creates illusion, and this is an illusion of the individual. And from here he starts the journey, and it goes on and on. And of course, we are not going to explore it out. But all these figures at the beginning, they are closed, which means they are separate. They have their limits. They fill the whole space, which means the individual here is everything, okay? Except in number six, which is the lover, okay, the love, okay, which it goes beyond, but that's just momentary, okay, something beyond with love, okay. But still, we are in the world of the individual, so it is all the particle, until we reach this, the particle collapses. Here, and even I think, even if it's like quantum observation, really, this collapse. It's called collapse of the wave function. Here, there's something on the upper right, okay? What is it? You don't know, okay? You just see the edge of it. So, and it's not really fire. So, what is it? So, it's material or immaterial, I don't know. But to me, it reminds me of like the observation, that something opening, okay? From the exterior. And this causes a collapse, and now you have these two possibilities that are on Earth, either forward or backward. So this is a split. It's like the cat either going alive or dead, okay? So you choose here, and this becomes, here reality becomes concrete. So you have all these particles flying around, okay? You see this individual, and You have here this concretization of reality on Earth. And then you pass to the other side, the next card, this is a wave. Okay? You see how it flows, how there are no limits, and the nakedness here, yeah? This is something which represents losing your limits, okay? Because there are no boundaries between self and exterior. And you see here even the body, you see here. I'll show it here. Okay? You see here, this is flowing as part of her body. So there's no, or here, you see, it's not clear where the object finishes and where the background. So there's a merging here, losing of boundaries, and then you lose your individual boundaries, you merge into the environment, and the sky opens up. You see? And in the next cards, you'll see naked figures and the sky. And it goes on and on like this for several cards. This is closed because it goes, I write about it in my book. It's not a linear story, it goes back and forth. So here's closed again. And you have to go to the underground, yes? Under the water to get through. But you have to find the solidity under the wave here to get through. But, and here you have some compromise. It's half naked, half closed. So there's something that you can contain. And again, yes, opening. Losing boundaries. Everything opens, okay? Everything is fresh, but there's no life here. Look, the earth is barren. And finally, we have this, again, balance between particle and wave, between nakedness in the middle, but a solid structure. It's like a magical ritual, yeah? That you have these boundaries which are solid, square, fixed, okay? And inside you can liberate yourself and remove your boundaries and connect with what? The individual from here, the navel, yeah? To the world, to the universal. So you start the Tao journey with an individual, you end it with the individual becoming the universal. So you start with particle, this material existence of the individual, and you end it when you find yourself again as something which is both particle and the wave. You find the wave inside the particle or underneath the particle, exactly as in quantum mechanics. So now we shall have a short break of 10 minutes, and then I will tell you some stories about Jodorowsky, who invented psychomagic, who understood that we have to reflect it back into our psychology, our inner psyche, and how to find the magic from there, and how to use tarot card for there. Okay, so 10 minutes break. Okay. First of all, some people ask me questions in the break. I am reachable by email through my website. You have my card there, or you can look me up in Google. So next week I'm back home. I can answer at leisure questions for those who want to go beyond what we say here. Okay. What is the point that we reached? We reached a point where we understand, okay, first of all, that reality is not something fixed. We can change it with consciousness. Okay? This is something very important, and for this I like films like The Blip, because people get out of it and they have the feeling that the walls are not something fixed there, okay? Okay, there are walls. But there are also ways to go beyond it. And one of the one of the workshops that I do with cards, with therapy cards, which we are not going to touch here. You can read a little in my website. I have this situation that I'm here and I'm in, and I want to change it. I want to go to another situation, and there's some blocking, some wall, something which doesn't let me go through. And in quantum mechanics, you have this idea of the electron which can move in this space, and it cannot pass through the wall, so it's trapped. Classical mechanics says trapped, but in quantum mechanics, you can come after a certain time and find it outside. And there are even electronic gadgets which work on this principle. They are called tunneling diodes. And the tunneling is just like the electron is digging a tunnel beneath the wall. Okay? So how can it do it? And the answer is that it passes as a wave. A wave does not have, particularly if it want to go from here to there, it has to pass through the wall because it has to be in a certain place at every moment. But as a wave, it is, there's some part of it on the other side. So it just lowers its presence here gradually and makes it bigger on the other side. So nothing passes, it's just shifting of presence from one side to another. And this was an inspiration to help people pass through the barrier, make a quantum jump in their life, find the part of you which is beyond, and strengthen it, okay? Make it stronger, okay? And make your presence here weaker, and gradually you'll find yourself beyond, even though you cannot pass the barrier. So it means that when you start to think in terms of waves, things are not so solid. And if things are not so solid, then you can go beyond them. But as I said, how? How do we do it? And the answer is a tradition. And here I have a very complex relationship with tradition because on one hand, we are modern people. We have different concepts. We have different ideas. We have different vision. So we cannot enter into the same world as a previous generation. On the other hand, we cannot be smarter than thousands of years of tradition, of history, because you cannot invent everything from new. So we have to respect something that was developed only to reinterpret it in a new way. And the strongest, most powerful one that I encountered was in the 80s when I studied in Paris. I was doing my doctorate, and then I encountered Alejandro Jodorowsky. He was teaching there once a week. Those of you who saw his film Dune, Jodorowsky's Dune, not Dune itself, but the film about the production, which is an amazing film. Okay, you must see it because it will blow your mind. And it's all true. It's real. Yeah? It really happened like this. And he's really like this. Greater than life, greater than our galaxy. And so it was just after the project collapsed. So he was there teaching small lessons of tarot and psychomagic to his groups, to people who went to study there. And he introduced me the idea of psychomagic, which is like Jung, who created the link between physics and mysticism and psychology. I say physics because Jung developed it while working with a physicist named Pauli, who came from quantum mechanics. And he went one step in this direction and said, okay, mysticism and magic are actually reflection of something inside us. He called it archetypes. And archetypes are part of our psyche, but also they can cause synchronicity in the world. So they are not something individual, they are something that touches the basis of reality. But that's as far as he went. And what Jodorowsky did, because he's an artist, and he's creator, and he's a surrealist theater and cinema creator, so he would create acts, symbolic acts, that are supposed to impress some kind of pattern in your subconsciousness. For example, you have this problem with your parents, so you go and do something either symbolic. He made someone once send a pair of scissors to her mother. Mother, okay, I cut this unhealthy relation, or things like this, or to go and do something on the grave of some person who died, either clean the grave and respect it. It's very traditional, okay? Because you owe him something, you have to return a favor. Or maybe, I once said a woman, she was sexually molested when she was a child by a relative and he died, okay? And she never spoke about it, and with the cards, the story comes out. So what to do? I said, okay, you cannot keep silent because you kept silent, you have to express it. But he has family, he has children, they did nothing wrong. Why? What do you do? So we thought, okay, she went, it was in Israel, yeah? She went to the cemetery where he was buried, and with letters, letters of tar, she wrote a vapor, yeah? Violator, I don't know. How, yeah? That's called, what the right word, okay? On his grave, like this. Okay? So it's like a statement, and it's public, and it's psychomagic, and afterward we met again, and we worked this idea, because it was something of liberation. Because, and this is what we know about Tarot, the act of, the symbolic act, is something which impresses, which touches the unconscious. This is the language of the unconscious. And this Jung understood, but he didn't go much further. And his students, most of them, went back to being academic, or semi-academic, so they did not want to develop this further. But we can go further if we ask, okay, what is the basic structure of magic? How does it work? And the basic structure is not so simple, but okay, it's simple to understand. First of all, there is this space and time. I write about it when I write about reading space, but when you do magic, it's always this space which is cut off the rest of the world, okay? So it's a ritual space, and you consecrate it, you isolate it, you make a circle, you write words of power, yeah? And you invest something in this cutting off of space and time from the rest of the world, but the object is not inside. The object is outside. Your life is there, outside, okay? So you come from outside, you pass the borders into this space, and here there are different rules. I mentioned it in the book because this is, for me, the basic law. Yes, I learned it originally from a French friend of mine who became a voodoo priest, and then he became crazy because he didn't know how to keep the limits. Okay, but he taught me some very powerful things, and he said, okay, in voodoo, everything is a sign. And then I realized that that's how it works. Everything is a sign. So everything is a sign. Everything is a symbol. Everything, yeah, you have this card, you have this card that turned up or fell down from your hand, or even Jung does it, yeah? You hear some crow at the middle of the session, because the therapeutic session of the psychologist, okay, is very much like a magical space. Anyone here knows Erwin Yalom? Erwin Yalom, the psychologist, yes, the gift of therapy. So he writes about it, working with the here of now, and with the here and now, okay? Which means everything here that happens here, even if it's unconnected to anything that you can think of, no, it's a sign of that the patient brings from this outside world, okay? And you have to interpret it, you have to work with it. And Jung was working with this kind of synchronicities, which means everything that happens here is symbolic, it has meaning. So you go beyond these limits of the individual, of the separation, which normally we have, which makes everything mechanistic, and say, no, things are connected, and they're connected by meaning and purpose, and the connection is here in this space. And then you do your thing, get out the cards, or do your magic ritual, okay? And sometimes you pass, okay? So this is, again, if you want to read Victor Turner, The Magical Ritual, The Magic Ritual, A Structure and Anti-Structure. It's a basic book in anthropology of magic. It's read by anthropologists. And he said, okay, so when you pass into the space, you change your clothes. Maybe you put down your clothes, you become naked, or you put some kind of a robe, which is the same for everybody. So you lose the structure of who you are in society, what is your status, okay? It's like in the cards. You start with very clear status, social status, magician, emperor, empress, pope, okay? And then you get to these naked figures at the end. They are symbolic. You don't know what they are doing in real life. Right? What is their social status, okay? Because they are mythology, they are human, okay? So you enter with your humanity into the space, and then you have this action that you do, symbolic actions, to gather information or to change, if it's magic, okay? And then you go out because your real life is outside. You do it for the outside, okay? And this is something that every magical tradition, you find this structure, okay? You enter, everything is a sign, you have a set of symbols, a symbolic language, and you do what you do here, and then you go out to the real life where it should work. So it's like visiting another level of reality where you connect to another level of consciousness. And inside this, okay, we know this already from quantum mechanics, you have to look for this experience which takes you beyond yourself, beyond your usual individual. Outside you are an individual, here you go beyond yourself. So maybe the gods or the powers or whatever will speak with you. It's all a language, okay? It's a kind of way to express what we feel. That something is beyond us and it's here, okay? And we are part of it. And we can connect with it and we can negotiate or manipulate or do something or receive some information or do some action. Okay, but there are two different processes. In one, we have divination. In divination, we take the symbols and it's like we throw them to the air. So the universe is answering us with a pattern. So it's either cards that we shuffle, okay? And again, there's some structure here, I write about it, but you have to touch it. It has to be connected with your own hands that determine the order of shuffling, but not in a way that you can control. And this you can find always. You can throw coins or shells or something which is scientifically or mechanistically is defined as a random, yes, but it comes from your action or it connected with you, okay? And you don't control it. So you cause it, but without conscious control. So it's like throwing it in the air. Yeah? And the universe imposes a pattern. In magic, it's opposite. So it goes deeper. Yeah? But you have the same language, and you can use the same objects, like the Chinese use the same objects for divination and for Taoistic magic. Okay? The same, you'll find the same bagua, the same trigrams, which are the objects, for example, okay? So, you have, or if you want, if you know a little the Renaissance tradition, which became the modern Western tradition, yes, you do magic by symbols of the planets, okay? So, what are the planets? It's alchemy, it's astrology, so you can get information from the planets, okay? But then you don't manipulate them, you just go to this causally unconnected, because every scientist will tell you there's no causal connection between planets and humans, okay? The divination is not with planets, it's with the astrological map, which is an arrangement of symbols. Okay? Again, it's like the cards. But in magic, you manipulate them, you choose, okay, let's work with Mars, or let's strengthen Mars, okay? So you don't leave the arrangement of the object to randomality or apparent randomality. You take the objects and you manipulate them, you put them in the pattern that you want. Okay? And then you have a moment which is the peak moment of the ritual, okay, which is some kind like Crowley's was working a lot about it, but of course every tradition, when you lose your conscious self in some, he did it ecstasy, so he used, because he liked this thing, sex, drugs, or in voodoo or in such kind of rituals, you go to ecstasy by dancing with the drums. Okay? Boom, 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 like in trance parties. Okay, boom, 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 boom. And then you get out of your individuality and you're absorbed. So kids do this today. Yeah? They take ecstasy and they boom, 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 boom. And after some hours, okay, they're not them. Okay, they feel the whole universe there. Okay, but they don't do it with a purpose. They don't do it in an orderly way, so it's just waste. Again, they are just wasted all over. But it's the same power, okay, which takes you beyond yourself. So it's like becoming a wave or connecting to your wave part. And this is a moment where the pattern puts itself into your unconscious. So when I realized this, I said, okay, why do I need other objects? I have all the objects that I need. These are the tarot cards. Okay? Ah, you need a sword and you need to forge it. No, I have this sword. Yeah. I can take the card, and it's the icon of the sword, but the pattern is enough to put itself on my subconscious. So what I understood, and Jodorowsky was doing this, but not in a very systematic way, because I'm not a creator like you. I cannot invent this whole magical universe every time from there. So I go to tradition. This is my safe place. Okay. So I try to observe the general structure and then change it as I feel is necessary. But there are some things which I can take from tradition, only that I understand it's symbol. The symbols have power. And if I have a set of tarot cards, which is strong enough, it has enough power in it, then I can use it in magic. Okay, so what do I need? Okay, so first of all, I need a space. And how do you do this space? Just a moment. Listen, I don't want to waste time on things which are on the internet. So you have Alejandro Jodorowsky on tarot cards, okay? I will teach you how to play this song. This is Jodorowsky on tarot.
Siempre me atrajo a mí cosas que me llamaron la atención.
No, stop. Okay. You can find it on. Look, Jodorowsky and tarot, okay? Let's not invest our time here, but okay, let's move on. Because there are some things that Jodorowsky does not do. Okay? I need a space. Now, what is a space? A space, a magical space, always has the four corners. Okay? And you put something to mark the four corners. North, south, east, west. Okay? Okay. So what I do is I use the four aces for this. I put them, you can find the correspondences in the Golden Dawn materials, or I have the table in my book. So it's very simple. In my own space that I use for reading, I just printed the four aces on cardboard, on canvas and framed it, and okay, they like this. So it's a permanent space. And people, when people enter, they say, okay, take off your shoes just to, for this passage from normal to another space, and it works. Okay? They enter, they feel they're in another world. It's just for reading, so we don't, for magical ritual, you have to do more, but okay. Yeah? This is enough for to cut off from the normal world and create another space. So you have this, okay, and I have this. There is a way that I go through your whole body. Again, you find the correspondence I took from Jodorowsky. You take from the feet. The feet are the material world, okay? The body, space, your money matters and things. And you concentrate on this, and then you move to the pelvis. This is the next one. The wand, okay? The sexual energy, creativity, and then you go here to the heart, emotion, and then you go on to the head, and then you can try this at home, yes, even with taking out one card at a time, and then the world, which is the fifth element, and this, okay, you go up, and then you wrap yourself like this in this light, and you take it back, and I repeat it three times, from under the feet, and then I finish here, like this, three times. Okay? Under and over, you have this, like the star, if you look closely, this thing here is actually the star, and if you look at her face, it's the same face and the same posture, like this, the higher part of the star card. Okay, so it's like the star there, okay, and you can imagine it on your head, and from here you take like this, and you wrap your head, and this gives you the integrity. This is a fish element. This is a consciousness, okay, which is individual and universal, because this is the world. What is the world? You are the world, okay, but it's a whole world. Okay? You are part of the world, and you are the whole world. Okay, so you can do this, and then what I suggest to people to do is to imagine, to make an impression of the pattern that you want to realize in your life, express it in cards. Okay? So when people find difficulty how to relate, so I say, okay, imagine now that you came for a reading, okay? And the reading told you exactly what you want. Okay? This you come to me, I say, the situation is going to be exactly as you wish. Okay? What cards are there? Okay? What cards are there? Do this arrangement of the card. Okay. And now, do some kind of a ritual. What does it mean, a ritual? That, do some adoration, light a candle. If we do magic, we do candle and a glass of water. Okay, fire and water. If I do tarot divination, I just do fire, just a candle. Okay, and there's something, but in this you must do something which represent giving something of yourself. Okay, some inconvenience, something that you convenience. So people were at all time, people were doing sacrifices or bringing something to the temple, or walking to the temple on their knees for kilometers, or rolling in the roads of India for this guru rolled three. I saw a film on this one, rolled like this 3,000 kilometers for several months to the temple of the goddess. Okay, so this is strong. You give something of yourself, and this is something that is always there in magic. Always you have to give something, to be, not give just money. Money, if you have a lot of money, then giving money is nothing for you, okay? Really something of yourself to show that you are serious, because this is a price to be paid. This is, the price is something which distinguishes will from fancy. Okay? And will is strength, and fancy is weakness. And if you remember from Crowley, will is a key. But will, okay, you have to pay. Yeah? To show that you are willing to go through difficulty. Okay, so you need to do something like this to invest something, and then you have your ideas or your methods. But what I do sometimes, okay, take the card and absorb its energy like this, okay, on your naked body. Okay? There's something about it always, some giving, that I never put out a flame by blowing on it. Always like this. Okay? Okay. You get burned from time to time. Okay. You won't die from this. Okay? No. I got burned in my life from flames like this. Every time, I deserve it. Okay? Yes. There was something I should pay. I should have paid attention, and it woke me up to something. And there's sometimes amazing things have happened after this. Okay, and things which are incredible. Right? That I go from Israel to India to Ethiopia and meet a key person from my childhood, who traveled all the way from the United States, and we recognize each other because we are table by table in the same hotel. The same. It's in my website. This story, okay? In English, also I put it. Now, there's something incredible like this. Where did this come from? Yes, and I still have this burning from the fire in the goddess temple in India, like this. Okay, so there's something that you give. You give from yourself and you get it, but you concentrate this energy on the cards, on this expression of your intent with the symbols. Now, with the major suite, it is complex because every card has different levels of meaning. Once I was in the first time I visited the United States, I was in the San Francisco, and then I went to Mexico. It was in 79, I think. No, it was in 1982. And I wanted to communicate with people, and I had difficulty of communication. So I prepared, I was working a Golden Dawn tradition, so I prepared a talisman with Mercury and the magician card, okay? So I go to San Francisco and I meet incredible people, and these people who later became the EFF, Electronic Frontier Foundation. At that time they were just a bunch of hippies with the journals, okay? So it really worked amazingly. And then I went to Mexico with the same talisman, and they stole my car, and they stole my belonging, and finally they stole the talisman also. Yes, because it is thieves and tricksters also. Yeah, it's a magician. So you should be careful. This is why I say, for people who don't really, are not really sure of what they are doing, take one of the aces, okay? But use it as a magical talisman. So there's one woman who goes to court. She has a very fierce fight in court and very vicious. I don't know. I don't even know the details. Okay, I just know that she has to go to court and it's going to be a fight, a real fight. But okay, and take the you need a sword to fight. Yes, okay. So take the ace of sword from the deck, wrap it in red clothes because red is a color of god of war and most tradition that we know, okay? Put it there in your purse, and every time you feel menaced, touch it. And it will give you this energy, and the person in front of you will feel it, but will not understand where it comes from. So it will get him scared. And so and this is how you prevail. And she went back for me, and they said, yes, she felt much stronger. She was not intimidated by the situation. She could control the situation because she had this concealed weapon. It was not a physical weapon. You cannot go with a physical weapon to court. Okay? But it's an energetic weapon. So this is what I'm suggesting to you to explore. You don't need all... Okay, you can... I can go there and buy all this stuff. Magical stuff. Yes, 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 yes. Sorry. No, of course, you can use the incense and the other thing to strengthen the ritual, but to express the what exactly do you want to achieve, okay? To express the pattern and to have this pattern on you, inside you, you can use the cards. And I sometimes use, I have large posters of the cards, okay? Listen, you can print the cards for my, because if you don't want to use your own deck that you use for your divination, or you don't have my cards or whatever, you can, on my website, you can find the pictures of all the cards. You can print them at home printing, or even better, the line drawings. I also release the line drawings. Just print the line drawings and color it by yourself, by hand. This is strong. Okay, so do it on good cardboard and make the coloration yourself. And in this way, you put your energy. Again, remember, you have to invest. Okay, you have to give something. So to color, this is strong. This impresses. And you can strengthen, first of all, you can start with these four elements. Go over your body. How do you feel with each of these elements, with this area of your life? If there's one which needs strengthening, take this ace. Maybe you can print it and hang it on the wall so you can see it or sleep with it. Absorb its energy because in a sense, you may be looking for all kinds of symbols, symbolic systems, but the Tao can do it. The Tao has enough power for this. So you can use Tao card as power objects. And this is for you to explore. Was I clear enough? Yeah?
Yes.
I don't know, maybe my English, I don't know. Okay? So I encourage you to start to play with the cards as magical objects and to think like this. And if you want to achieve something, take the card, put it in front of you, make some ritual, make some something, yeah, to concentrate. You can do it. I sometimes do it with stones. Okay? You can do the ritual and have a stone. I don't work with the fixed meaning of the stones. I work by feeling and texture and color. Okay, so you go to the shop and you pick a stone that gives you this right feeling, and you do this ritual. You make it the contact with your card, and then you can take the stone. And the stone is a power object that you can carry with you. Okay? So into the world. So again, this is something that you can explore. This is all you need is your body and a deck of cards. And a candle, and some water, yeah? And some more things that you can, yeah? That you can. Remember, you have to invest, huh? Okay. So this is it. I think our time is finished. I don't know if we have time for a few questions. Do we have time? We don't have to close. Okay. So just some quick. If somebody wants to, no, everybody's tired. Nobody wants to go home. Okay, so I thank you for being here and for your participation.